Hi, everybody. Welcome, and thank you for taking the time to come together as community this morning. When it became clear that most of us would be going home for the semester, I initially thought that the why of chapel would have to shift in this new context. But I soon realized that encountering Jesus together is even more important than ever, especially since our community has been scattered all over the world. So we will be posting chapel videos to YouTube Monday, Wednesday, and Friday at the regular chapel time of 11 a.m. And we invite you to join in watching at that time as a sort of virtual community. The content of chapel will remain largely similar to a normal chapel. We'll have worship leaders leading us in song, where you at home can sing, listen and meditate, or pray. We've invited friends who will open God's word and encourage us, and we will close with the doxology. I do not promise high production levels. For the most part, everything will be recorded on iPhones and similar devices, but I hope that you'll actually love the transparency that comes with imperfect modes of communication. So again, welcome. I wish we were together in the chapel, but I trust and pray that in the next half hour or so, the Father, through the Holy Spirit, will give us the gift of encountering Jesus together, that we might be strengthened in our faith and united in our fellowship, with a prayer that hope may abound at this unique time. So now, let's prepare our hearts to encounter Jesus together and to worship as Hallie Blair Quattro and a guest lead us in a time of worship.
Hey guys, I hope that everybody's been doing well in this very crazy and interesting time. I'm super thankful to be able to worship with you guys in such a unique and different way. It's very, very bizarre because nobody's actually here except for us. And it's really hard to make these videos, actually. But I am hoping that these two songs will be a blessing to you guys and that you can worship through them. And I think that both of these songs are very prayerful, so definitely feel free to think of them as a prayer as you sing. So would you sing "Heal Us, Emmanuel" with us? Amen. hopes and fears we come to touch you if we may. Oh, send us not despair. Dear Lord, in this crazy time, it's been hard to be faithful and to trust in you one day at a time. It's been hard to not just give in to fear. Lord, we need your presence every passing hour. It's so true. Today, I want to lift up every person who has been affected by this virus and this sickness. Lord, I lift up all the doctors and the nurses, the hospitals and countries that have been affected in any way, Lord. And I also lift up Covenant to you, this wonderful place with all the faculty, staff, and students. Lord, I lift them up to you and I pray for healing. I pray for comfort. I pray for just your mighty presence. And Lord, now I pray for Chaplain Lowe as he speaks to us, that your presence would be strong and powerful with him as he speaks. Lord, you know very well that we really, really need people like Chaplain Lowe to speak your truth to us right now. And it's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Good morning and happy Monday. And welcome to my living room. I know the red room in Jane Eyre is the scary room, but I assure you that that red room is a very cozy and happy red room. You will notice that right there is a bonsai tree that I've had for almost 15 years, and it's in full bloom right now, so I put it there because it makes me happy. It is actually not Monday or morning, and I am acutely aware that I am speaking to a camera on my phone and not directly to you. Still, I am genuinely, and have been actually all day, excited about the sense that we are somehow here together right now for chapel. So please don't begrudge me my delusion. It is born out of an honest desire to be with you all. I am also acutely aware of the irony that it's by virtue of the same technology that we outlaw in chapel that we are able to come together as community this morning. That is not lost on me, and I find it quite funny. Let me start by saying how sorry I am that we're having to do this chapel like this, because it represents the realities of the coronavirus and how our community has been scattered. I know that this is not how any of you expected to finish the semester. The fact that we're apart means that there are lots of plans and hopes and good things that you were looking forward to that have just sort of disappeared. I feel that loss too, as does our faculty, staff, and the cabinet, but we know that it's nowhere as acute as what you as students are experiencing. I'm also especially sorry for our seniors. In what was already a time of pretty crazy and daunting transition, of starting to look at closure on your college experience, on preparing for your future studies and vocations, this time I'm sure is hitting you with extra ferocity. I'm really sorry that we don't get to walk in that together for the next few months, at least in the ways that we expected that we would. Not being together for the last week and a half or so has helped me to see with new eyes a passage from Bonhoeffer's Life Together that I've always liked, and I'd like to read it. I think it's appropriate for this time. It's easily forgotten that the fellowship of Christian brethren is a gift of grace, a gift of the kingdom of God that any day may be taken from us, that the time that still separates us from utter loneliness may be brief indeed. Therefore, let him who until now has had the privilege of living a common Christian life with other Christians praise God's grace from the bottom of his heart. Let him thank God on his knees and declare, "It is grace, nothing but grace, that we are allowed to live in community with Christian brethren." So I praise God and his grace from the bottom of my heart for our community, for you. And I join you in missing that grace now. Over the last week or so, I've heard a number of references to a new normal or maintaining a sense of normalcy. And it's made me think of what we mean when we talk about normal. I think when most of us say normal, we're usually referring to what we're used to. The degree of experiencing the fall in our daily lives that we expect and that we accept. The degree of experiencing common and special grace in our daily lives that we expect and accept. And we call that normal. But Scripture is clear that followers of Jesus have an expected normal. And it's a hard normal. Our normal is to face persecution as he was persecuted, to be hated as he was hated, that we will face tribulation and trial and hardship. But it's not just persecution because of our faith. It's all of the present sufferings that we experience as Christians sojourning in a world that's impacted by sin. There's never a promise in all of Scripture for ease or comfort or control. There's no promise of a normal that's okay. What we're experiencing now is normal. It's just not expected. The reason I mention that is because that idea that this is normal gives me hope. I think it should give all of us a degree of comfort. It should serve as a gentle reminder that what's happening is not outside of the Father's control. But more than the fact that it's not outside of his control, it's not outside of his care and his love, and both his willingness and desire to be with us in our every waking moment. I hope that you'll take some comfort in that, as I have, and I've been reflecting on that. As I've been praying for you over the last week and a half or so, three themes keep coming up. Themes that I've noticed keep reemerging as I pray. The themes of loneliness, anxiousness, and community. And I wanted to share a few thoughts about each in hopes that your hearts will be encouraged by what God has to say about those three things. I know that isolation can bring loneliness, but it's important, I think, that we know you are not alone. In the fourth chapter of James, James is addressing God's people who are living these self-focused, disobedient lives, these lives of self. And James offers them this really life-shaping promise. He says, "Submit yourselves then to God. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Come near to God, and he will come near to you." This, I think, is one of the most amazing, encouraging promises of God. Draw near to him, and he will draw near to us. I know the physical isolation that many of you are in is for a lot of people dwarfed by the loneliness that you're experiencing. You're away from friends, away from community, away from your church families. But you don't have to be lonely. God will draw near to you as rock and refuge. But how? Very practically, I encourage you to submit yourselves to the Father, to draw near to him by creating daily liturgies. by creating these practices that will shape your time and calibrate your heart each day. Things that will set a tone and even a tune for how you live. I know this isn't a new concept, but it is a new time. And new times give us opportunities to evaluate, to repent, to submit, to commit, to rejoice, to enter in. So think about your day and how you structure it. Some very practical things, the couple I've been doing and things I would encourage. Listen to things like psalm tones, or listen to music in the morning that will call you into God's presence and set a tone for the day. Read God's word to us in the morning before you pick up your phone, before you do other things. Set up scheduled times to pray. Pray in the morning and in the afternoon and in the evening. At night, reflect on the day and give God thanks before bed for the blessings that you've seen, for the day that he's given you to live. Exercise your image bearerness and create good things. Don't let this be a time that gets kind of waffled away. Don't let it be a wasted time that sort of dissipates into just other things. Make it a priority to calibrate and to draw near to God, that he might draw near to you. And I promise this is doable. When we make things priorities, we can make them happen. I was reflecting when I was in my late 20s, I started lifting weights for the first time seriously. And I was lifting weights with a buddy of mine who was a defensive lineman at the University of Massachusetts. And in order to get stronger and in order to put on muscle, which I had really never done in my life, I had to eat copious amounts of food, primarily protein. So I was eating upwards of like 200 plus grams of protein a day, and drinking gallons of milk, protein powders, but I was eating a ton of tuna. And I got so tired of eating tuna out of a can that I started to think of how I could create vehicles for the tuna. So I started throwing orange juice into a blender, throwing cans of tuna in with the orange juice, blending it, creating basically an orange juice tuna smoothie and drinking it. Was it terrible? Yes. Did it work? Yes. Because I had made it a priority. I pray that you will trust God's promise that if you resist the devil, that he will flee from you. But more importantly, that if you come near to the Father, that he will come near to you. I know that a lot of people are also experiencing anxiousness. And scripture is clear that there is a place for the anxious. Psalm 91 talks about the Lord as our refuge. It says, he will cover you with his feathers, and under his wings you will find refuge. His faithfulness will be your shield and your rampart. I think that's what Paul is talking about in Philippians chapter 4. We all know the verses 6-8. Do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your requests to God, and the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. When our tendency is to be anxious, to be worried and overwhelmed, Paul says, don't be. He says, don't sit in it alone. Don't internalize. It's not to be born alone. When you rely on self, you incline yourself towards anxiety, because we are not meant to, or are we capable of, bearing alone the hard things of the world. And then there's that beautiful but in there. Do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation. Instead, and here's the alternative, lay it at the Father's feet. Prayer and petition means that you're coming into the presence of God, that you're casting your burdens upon him. You're doing it honestly, and you're doing it in faith. And that brings a peace beyond what we can understand, and a peace that will guard our hearts and our minds. I don't pretend that that is easy, but God promises that it's true. I pray that you'll be able to trust this, that you might practice it, and that you might come to know it. Finally, a word about community. I know that you know we are connected as the body of Christ, that we are temples of the living God dispersed all over the world. But I know that more immediate are feelings of sadness, longing, even heartbreak of being separated so quickly, not getting to say proper goodbyes, considering seniors that you may not get to say goodbye to like you had hoped, having friendships that were experiencing sweet times of growth, and maybe even having friendships that were under strain where there wasn't resolution and you weren't able to work through things that you knew you needed to. So what do you do? How do you approach community when you've been separated from community? And I think what we should do is look to Paul's example when he was in prison. He was separated from the churches that he loved. He rejoiced in the good things that he heard. He was sad at the suffering that he learned about. He longed to see them and to be with them. And all of those things translated into him pouring out his heart for them before God. It translated into him praying passionately for the people that he loved. If you look at the books that he wrote when he was in jail, Ephesians, Philippians, Colossians, Philemon, there's this theme, this strong theme of prayer for the people that he loved and that he was separated from. In Ephesians, I've not stopped giving thanks for you, remembering you in my prayers. Philippians, I thank my God every time I remember you. In all my prayers for all of you, I always pray with joy. Colossians, we always thank God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, when we pray for you. For this reason, since the day we heard about you, we have not stopped praying for you. And Philemon, I thank my God always, making mention of you in my prayers. I pray that you will follow God's example, that you will pray fervently for your community, that you'll pray for your friends, you'll pray for the people that you miss, you'll pray for the people that you know are hurting, that you'll pray prayers of thanks for good, that you'll weep before God over the sad, that you will lift up the hurting and the broken, and that you'll even plead for kindness and mercy and restitution and resolution where it's needed, and that you will pour out your longing to be united. And I pray that that being reunited will be that much sweeter because we have prayed and because you have prayed for your brothers and sisters. In one of our recent cabinet meetings, Jeff Hall prayed that God in his mercy would bring unexpected good out of this time and that we might have the eyes to see it. Since God promises that he works all things for good for those who love him and are called by him, I pray that we will be expectant and that we'll be humble and that the good works that God allows us to see will make us love him and praise him more and in ways that perhaps we never have. Let's pray and then we'll sing the doxology together. Father, we thank you for the privilege of being part of the Covenant College community. We thank you, Lord, that we are knit together by the blood of Jesus, that we are indwelt by your Spirit, and so become your children. We thank you that you love us. We thank you that you love us so much that you sent your Son to become a man, fully God, fully man, that he might know every single temptation that we face. Thank you, Father, that we never stand alone and that you walk in every instance with us. Father, I pray that you would strengthen us in our faith, and I pray that you would strengthen us in our unity, despite the fact that we are scattered literally all over the world, that in the prayers that we lift up for one another, our love for one another would be deepened. And I pray, Father, that you would draw near to us as we draw near to you. I pray, Father, that you would by your Spirit, call us close to you and call us deeper into relationship with you. Father, please be gracious. Protect us in this time of pandemic. I pray that you would be present by your Spirit to the hurting, that you would lift them up and comfort them, You would be with those who are lonely, those who are anxious, those who are just restless. Lord, I do pray that this could be a sweet time full of blessing that is truly unexpected. And we look forward with longing to the day when we get to reunite on Lookout Mountain at Covenant College to walk alongside one another and to live life together. Please be with us in the meantime, Lord. Bless us through Christ and by your Spirit, we pray. Amen. Let's sing the doxology together.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Thy prayer.